Thank you for coming today. This is a PowerPoint presentation entitled Marcellus Money and the Pennsylvania Legislature. We've been working on this for six, 7 weeks, put a lot of time into it. Bobby Denault from my office has done a lot of legwork and put up with me over the gathering these slides. But this was born out of an increasing amount of frustration among myself and people who care about the environment with regard to the inability of this legislature to enact good public policy relating to the environment due to the influence of the natural gas drilling industry and the large amounts of money they spent. I don't know if anyone remembers Clarence Bell. He was a Delaware County senator before Senator Pileggi, very practical man. And I think what he says is very true. And I'm going to ask you to view when you consider viewing the contributions and lobbying expenditures here through this lens. I think it's I think there is something expected in return for all this money. So the purpose of the gathering of all this information is to show the large amounts of money the natural gas industry spends on the Pennsylvania legislature in terms of lobbying and campaign contributions, the policy consequences of this, for example, the inability to pass a severance tax, the inability to get conventional drilling regs passed, the inability to get the Royalty Protection Act passed, let alone things like expanding renewable energy. To sort of discuss some of the problems in the current campaign finance laws and lobbying laws, and maybe discuss that allows this to happen, and maybe just discuss some recommended changes. We gathered a lot of data, but I think first want to give kudos to Common Cause and the conservation voters of Pennsylvania. They really did a lot of the initial work here. They since about 2014 and maybe before, have putting out reports that haven't been getting enough attention. I've been working with Barry Kaufman, their former executive director, on this project. He's been very generous with his time. Unfortunately, they just don't have the funding to carry this forward. And we expanded what they've done a little bit. We've gotten a little broader. But I do want to thank them for the great work that they've done. So what we did, we started out with the database that they have collected, and we really continued with their methodology. And we looked at campaign finance reports for the second half of 2016 for the 42 natural gas companies they've identified through their methodology, which we footnoted in this report. We've also looked at my office independently for those 42 natural gas companies, all of the lobbying quarterly reports for the past 2 years that shows their expenditures and breaks it down a bit. In addition, we looked at their registration statements. And then we looked at the statements of financial interest for 2015 of every House member and every senator. 2016s are not available yet. We don't have to file until a little later this year. I think that what we're going to do, and I do think the system is rigged. I think that when you consider the influence of the drilling industry and how it is difficult to get this stuff passed, it's certainly not a level playing field. So what we're going to do in the next 25 slides or so is talk about first the campaign finance findings we made, then the lobbyist disclosure findings we made, then the statement of financial interest findings we made, the consequences, and then some possible solutions. So what we found was last year the gas industry spent over $883,000. We did not report the or count the individual contributions for the second half of 2016, so this number is understated. You'll see the Consol Energy was the biggest contributor to the legislature last year with $136,000, EQT and others behind them. And I think it's fair to say that most of these companies have a financial interest in the legislative outcome here as far as blocking a severance tax and blocking the conventional regulations and other issues they might have relating to fines that have been imposed upon them and other things they want and need. So they're sort of highly motivated to contribute to the legislature. As far as the monies received, Speaker Terzai, and I'll just stop at this point and say I like Michael Terzai. I think he's doing I really like the way he comports himself at the podium. I've said that to him many a time. So I have nothing personal against Mike. I hope he's not offended by this. But he was the main recipient in 2016 of natural gas industries monies, receiving over $78,000, followed by the House Republican Campaign Committee down the line. I think one thing you can note from this is that most of the money here went to Republicans, and not to make this a partisan thing, but I think it's the money goes, frankly, where those people who have are in a position to control the flow of legislation. So most of the money here went to Republicans. Just breaking down Mike Terzai's money a bit, you see that the biggest two contributions he got was a $20,000 contribution last year from Consol. EQT gave him $10,000. And he got assorted contributions from us. Again, this does not include the individual contributions he may have received, just the gas industry PACs we've identified. This breaks down the House and Senate Republican campaign committees, what they received from the natural gas industry, $56,000 on the House side and $39,000 on the Republican side. And again, Senator Scarnati, this is he received over $50,000 from the gas industry last year in assorted amounts. Senator Cormann, we actually combined his totals, just to be clear, with Build PA PAC, and we sort of explain that in the footnotes because the chairman and the treasurer of both those PACs are identical. They're both people from his county, and we explain it a little better. But in our view, they are pretty much one and the same. So that's why we combined them. Now, this is interesting, and again, this feeds off an idea that Common Cause initially presented in their report. We looked at Chairman Marr, the Environmental Committee, and he received $20,000 this year from the natural gas industry, and we break it down. But I think an observation that Common Cause made in their report was when he was chairman of the Ag Committee in 2014, he got less than $2,000. But when he moved to be chairman of the Environmental Committee in 2015, he received over $23,000, and again, 2016, over $20,000. And, you know, I think the point to be made is that contributions are to be made to people who have influence. And I think one of the most damaging things that Chairman Marr did as the in his committee was when Senate Bill 792 moved through, which became Act 52, that canceled the conventional drilling regulations, and that eventually it canceled the conventional drilling regulations, which really was bad public policy and really put the environment and public health in a worse position. Okay, and we've just covered campaign finance, and this is the lobbying portion. One of the interesting things we did, we looked at all of those 43 principles that were identified by Common Cause, and then we looked at who they list as their lobbyists. And when we totaled all that up, we found that there are 203 lobbyists working on the behalf of the gas industry, 203. And then just coincidentally, that's one for each state House member. And I think that's kind of a large figure of lobbyists that just sort of gives you the extent of the influence of lobbying in the legislature. And I see it, you know, people who are in the Capitol see it. When I go to a Environmental Resource and Energy Committee, you see the well-heeled lobbyists in the back filling the place. You can't walk through the corridors of this building without seeing Marcellus industry lobbyists at the various congestion points and so forth. So their presence is really all over the place. But that just sort of quantifies the fact that there's over 200 gas industry lobbyists currently registered in Pennsylvania. And what we found was that just in 2016, they spent over $7 million. When you add up the totals on their reports, they spent over $7 million just this last year lobbying the legislature. And again, I want to give credit to Common Cause for this figure, because the bulk of this figure was due to their gathering. So kudos to them on that. But they've spent over $60 million in lobbying expenses, lobbying this legislature since 2007. I think that's startling. That's a lot of money. So I wanted to wanted to focus on the Marcellus Shale Coalition. And we looked at their quarterly reports for 2015 and 2016. And these are the 2015 reports. They are spending right in that $930,000-$940,000 quarter after quarter. When we reviewed the reports, this is what we came up with. And I want to give you an idea of, this is their report. This is a complete report of the Marcellus Shale Coalition for the last quarter of 2015. And I think this is it. This is what they have to report to disperse almost $1 million. I think what's important here is how little it does disclose. It discloses the names of four lobbyists, three categories of expenditures, and just a broad listing of the subject matter. With this $1 million, no legislators here receiving gifts. There's no specific bill numbers that they've lobbied on, just a broad category of gifts, which in this case was about, they indicated $585, cost of communication. So this is it. This is all they have to report for $1 million, almost $1 million worth of expenditures. And I think that points, we'll talk about this in a little bit, it's one of the problems with our current lobbying law, how little they really have to report. You know, and this is just a little oddity that we came up with. We don't really have an answer to this, but we just really wanted to put it out there. When we were tracking their 2015 expense reports for the Marcellus Coalition, and they filed first quarter, again, continuing with the same pattern, $933,000 for the first quarter, second quarter, $934,000, third quarter, $933,000. And then something very odd happened, because in the last couple of days of January, all of a sudden the reports had changed. Now, all of a sudden they changed this 933 to 167. They changed that 934 to 178 and so forth. And they changed that, and we have no idea why. We have no idea how you can make an adjustment of that magnitude. That's still an unanswered question. We sat down with the Pennsylvania Department of State last Monday on this. We spoke with Deputy Secretary Torres and Jonathan Marks and brought this to their attention, and they're going to get back to us. But I do think it's an unanswered question at this point. What's we got here? I think this points out the problem there is with regard to gift reporting. When we looked at these lobbying reports for 2016, almost $80,000 in gifts were on the lobbying reports, $80,000 worth of gifts. But there wasn't a single legislator's name listed on any of the lobbying reports of the entire industry. No legislator was named as receiving gifts. Where did the money go? I mean, that's the problem. I think the problem is the threshold requirements are simply just too high. So all of this $80,000 in gift giving just goes right under the radar. Right now, under current law, you don't have to report a gift if you're a principal, unless it's more than $250 per year, and you don't have to report it transportation, lodging, and hospitality if it's more than $650 a year. So although there's a lot of spending, there's a lot of whining and dining, everyone knows that, not a single legislator's name appeared on any lobbyist report for the year 2016. Nor did any bill number. And again, I think this sort of this underscores the same point. We looked at the financial statements of and financial statements, just in case you don't know, every public official has to file a statement of financial interest, which has to record the gifts that person has received. And of the 253 legislators who filed, only five reported receiving gifts, and they only totaled $80,000. This is 215, not to confuse you. We had to shift back to 215 on this statistic because 216s are not available. So in 215, almost $70,000 were reported in gifts on the lobbying reports, but only $8,000 show up on the statement of financial interest. Again, the problem is the reporting thresholds. They're just too high. All this just goes right under the under the radar. I don't want to pick on Dave Reed, because I like Dave Reed. I think Dave does a real nice job as majority leader, and you know, he's a bright guy and a clean-cut guy. I have no problems with him. But we picked his report to illustrate two things. We wanted to just let you guys know what a financial statement of financial interest looks like, and also show that one of the most influential people in Harrisburg, someone who undoubtedly gets gifts, transportation, hospitality, and lodging, indicates nothing for 2015. Again, it's not that he hasn't complied with the law. He's fully complied with the law. I know he's complied with the law. I'm quite confident just knowing Dave. But it all goes under the radar. All you have to do is just make sure from each individual of those 42 gas companies, just keep it under, you know, 649 for one category and 249 for the other. So the problems with the current law is thresholds are just too high. So we now want to move into the consequences. You know, what's the consequences of all this undue influence of the natural gas industry on the legislature? And I think as far as cost to taxpayers, there's an enormous cost in our inability to pass the severance tax. That was first introduced by Governor Rendell in 2009, first proposed by him. And we remain the only major gas-producing state without a severance tax. It's something we just should do. And according to the Department of Revenue, this current budget we're in, 16-17, we're losing about $153 million in revenues. And that's factoring in what we are getting from the impact fee. We're losing $153 million this year. And we are also, over time, we have lost since fiscal year 11-12, it's well over $1 billion because I think the PA Budget and Policy Center said it was $1.2 billion. In their 2014 report. So it's well beyond this at this point. So the first consequence, I think, of the undue influence of the gas company is money out of taxpayers' pockets. And I think the second thing is the health and safety. The conventional drilling regulations, these are just really basic stuff. I mean, these are just some of the highlights. You know, just requiring conventional drillers before they drill to do a pre-drilling review, so you don't drill into another abandoned well or existing well. Just the requirement that you restore water supplies to safe drinking water standards, just basic stuff. These regulations were found to be in the public interest by our Independent Regulatory Review Commission. They have overwhelming public support. The comments were overwhelmingly in support of them. But year after year, they're blocked. I mean, it happens in the fiscal code. Year after year, these conventional drilling regs are, and that's important. It's just basic stuff. And I guess from the drilling industry perspective, it's better to give $1 million in lobbying and just save the cost it would to comply with this or pay the severance tax. But renewable energy, you know, again, Pennsylvania's a very important state, produces 1% of the world's greenhouse gases, but only about 4.4% of the electricity we generate comes from renewable sources. And, you know, I've beat my head against the wall trying to expand the alternative energy portfolio standard. The lobbying interests against it are just too hard, too difficult to deal with. The royalty protection bill, that's the Garth Everett bill that gives landowners that minimum 12.5% value of gas. They lease their land in good faith to companies like Chesapeake and others in exchange for what they believe is a 12.5% royalty. And some of these people have been getting negative checks. You know, gas companies said you owe us money, or checks in the amount of 13 cents. And I watched this bill in the past two terms. It gets closer and closer to floor passage. I've watched it move through committee. And I see these poor landowners coming to town with high hopes. Finally, they're going to get justice. And I see it stall. Right before it gets to a floor vote, and it's so predictable. And I just want to say to these landowner association people, don't you get it? Don't you get it? The system's rigged. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen because the gas industry just has a control over this chain, this building. I think that the lobbying law that we passed in 2006 is a perfect example of this. You know, we passed that bill, and I voted against it because I knew exactly what it was. And people who like Common Cause, who are familiar with the issue, knew what that bill was all about. It was the appearance of reform without the reality. And I think when you consider reform measures proposed by state reps and senators, you really have to consider whether it's real or just, the late Mark Russell said, a bunch of overweight white guys just pretending to hurt each other. What needs to change? I mean, we've been trying to do this for years, so let's not kid ourselves. But certainly contribution limits are, we need contribution limits. What you've seen being given is just way too high. It's way too high. We're all humans. When you get a contribution of $20,000, I think it's more to expect of a person that they're not going to react to that in some way. Is that going to happen this year? Of course it's not. We all know that. But I think there is a good first step. And I know that, you know, Bobby, when we were working with these search capabilities, when we were doing our search, when we got onto the Department of State's website and searched, it was really difficult. We have a really poor search capabilities. Now, for example, you know, if you're a legislator, you might have to file six, seven reports in the course of a year. You know, your first cycle, second cycle, third cycle, and so forth. When you use the Department of State site, you have to stick in one cycle. The search does not allow you to go between cycles. So, for example, if you wanted to, picking on Speaker Terzai again, if you wanted to find out how much, let's say, range resources gave to him over the five election cycles, you'd have to go through 35 different reports. And that just, in this state of computer technology, there's just no reason. There's no reason for this. So if Governor Wolf wanted to really take the first step, I think the first step he could do in this area is just improve the Department of State's campaign finance search site. And we did when we met with the Department of State. We did discuss this change, and we're going to be following up on that. Lobbying disclosure. I mean, I think here's what I've observed in the last 25 years, the strategy of lobbyists. You know, I mean, they want to become your friends. They want to take you to dinner, take you to the ball game, you know, give you cigars, what have you. They want to become your friends. because, you know, when they need something, when they need to vote on an amendment, it's like, come on, can you help me out here? Because, you know, we're friends and friends help out friends, right? That's wrong. That's the wrong role for lobbyists. Lobbyists have a very legitimate role, a constitutionally protected role to petition their government, but they should not be our friends. They should be strictly providers of information. I think it's entirely appropriate that we should not be receiving any gifts from lobbyists. The total gift ban is what should be we should be striving for. But short of that, first penny disclosure, which means anything a lobbyist gifts you has to be reported. The bill in 2006 did not change the culture in Harrisburg. And to do that, constituents need to know, I think, and I said this in my floor speech in 2006, which lobbyist is giving what gift to what legislator for what bill? Those four things. And if people back home knew this, if they knew their legislator took a vote, let's say blocking the conventional drilling rigs, and saying, well, why'd you do that? But they had the information that a lobbyist from Range gave them, you know, X, and the bills reported, you could start to tie gifts to legislative actions. That might cause legislators to get stung a bit in newspaper articles and may change the culture in Harrisburg a little bit. Oh, that went fast. Okay, so that's the end of the presentation, and I would be happy to answer questions anybody has. Nothing? Okay, well, okay, there you go.
Bob. I understand, especially with the House Environmental Committee, yeah, over the years, like, right, there's been a geographic imbalance of members on that committee, mainly from the western part of the state. There's only one person on it from the northeast region right now, Mike Carroll.
Right.
And just, what have you been on the committee for a long time? What have you noticed about the selection of members on that committee?
Yeah, no, I was actually, before they took me off, I was on that committee for 24 years. And I became chairman 4 years ago. And I think that made Frank Dermody a bit nervous. And I do notice that they packed on the Democratic side a lot of legislators who really were not with us on things. Democrats were not with us. I won't mention names, but Democrats who are not with us on things like renewable energy and climate change and responsible drilling regulations. I suspect it was to make sure I didn't do anything crazy, but yeah, I mean, I think that's that was a very tough committee composition, and I did, just for the record, request my only committee assignment request was to be on the environmental committee this term. It was not put on it. So yeah, it's I have noticed that, especially, you know, when I became chair four years ago. Yeah.
Jake Corman argued right after Governor Wolf gave his budget.
I'm sorry?
Jake Corman?
Jake Corman, Governor.
Argued right after the governor gave his budget address this week that to put a tax on the industry when it's already in a depressed state would chase jobs away, and that seems to be the argument of a lot of leaders, that is, to tax them would be to hurt the industry. Do you agree with that, and what's your response?
I don't.
Again, this is a small cost of doing business. The production levels of these companies remain high, even though the value they're getting for the gas is not as high as it once was. The price that they're going to get for gas, it's a cyclical thing. And if you charge based on a percentage, I think Governor Wolf is suggesting 6.5%. Maybe that's a starting negotiating point. But I think 5 or 6% is fair. I mean, when you look at what the capital expenditures they make and all the other expenditures they make, that severance tax would be a very small portion of that. You know, the same companies, you know, the Marcellus shale formation goes beyond Pennsylvania. So you get a company like EQT that's both in West Virginia and Pennsylvania. I mean, they're paying it one state, they're not paying it in the other, and they're drilling in both states. So I've heard that argument. Just don't buy it. Just don't buy it.
And campaign contributions and lobbying is legal here. You think the whole system's messed up?
I mean, the major
thesis here is that the Marcellus industry has way too much influence over the Pennsylvania legislature, and that's resulting in bad fiscal and environmental policy. And we need to, I think the public needs to understand what's happening and react to it. And at the polling boxes, you know, be aware how their legislators are reacting. And it's difficult. I mean, I'm just having tried for almost a quarter of a century to change some of these laws, I'm not going to say it can be done with a snap of the finger, but that's not to say nothing can be done. And that's not to say that if the public paid closer attention, we wouldn't get better outcomes.
What is the likelihood if a severance tax passes? The governor, for the third straight budget, has called for a severance tax. What is the likelihood that that passes this year?
I mean, I'm the wrong person to ask, because every term I'm thinking, of course it's going to pass this year. This makes total sense, and it never does. I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I have no idea. I mean, I just, you can only look at the past as an indicator, and we've been trying to get this done a long time.
And in chatting with some people from the Marcellus industry, they said, well, are you going to ask Representative Vitali about the influence of PSEA, for instance, which also has numerous dollars here? Have you done the research on that, and what impact does that have on Democratic voters?
No, that's a good point. And I do think that, you know, the undue influence of special interest groups on the legislature is not limited to the drilling industry. And we probably get some bad education policy due to undue influence too. We probably get other bad policies shaped by contributions of other special interest groups. And if we make changes like this, they could all be addressed. I think maybe another way to look at it is you look at with regard to these environmental issues. You know, you might look at the money being spent by the Marcellus industry versus some environmental nonprofits or other people who are on the other side of these issues, and it's simply not a level playing field. But there's no doubt that, you know, if you look at some of the contributions in other areas, I'm thinking of a fellow from Montgomery County who makes all sorts of Republican contributions and gets nice breaks with regard to charter schools, but it happens. It happens in more areas than gas drilling.
And I think some of your colleagues could argue it's a chicken and an egg argument. If Jake Corman truly believes we shouldn't be imposing on this industry, then the dollars followed him because he believes that, or did the dollars come first and then he created that argument? And I don't mean to single out Jake, whoever.
I
understand what you're saying. Do the people who run for office get the money from the drilling industry because of the views they hold, or do they change those views because they're getting the money once they're in office? And I guess it's hard to say specifically, but I do know that getting all this money has a bad effect.
And those numbers you had for 2016 in here, you said they're not complete. Was that just at the halfway mark?
The numbers you're seeing, and we have a footnote that explains that, the numbers you're seeing, we looked at the campaign expense reports for the entire year for those 42 companies. Now, Common Cause did the first half of the year, and that also includes individual contributions. We, because of resource limitations, only did the PACs for the second half of 2016. So that's right. Second half of 2016 does not include individual contributions. So that figure, the 800 plus figure, is understated a bit. We put up all this, we put up a lot of information on my legislative website, the PowerPoint, the list of those 203 lobbyists, some charts relating to the lobbying reports and expenditures. So they're up there and they're going to remain up there. So you can take a look at that and call me if you have any other questions. But that's it. Well, thank you all for coming. Really appreciate it. Thank you.